Szeretettel köszöntöm a Capa Központ Gyógyír című kiállításához kapcsolódó a Tükör, Pszichológia, Analízis és Fotográfia című online előadás sorozat iránt érdeklődőket. Geller Judit vagyok, a Capa Központ kurátora. A mai vendégünk Judy Weiser, aki az alapítója és vezetője a kanadai székhelyű fototerápiás centrumnak. Judy előadásában arról fog beszélni nekünk, hogy miként tudnak a fényképek a segítségünkre lenni, ezáltal egy bevezetést hallhatunk majd a fototerápia és a terápiás fotózás eszközeiről és lehetőségeiről. Thank you, Judy.
Jó napot! Hello everybody and köszönöm, Judith Geller. Thank you very much for inviting me to be part of this conference around the exhibition Cure currently at the Capa Gallery in Budapest. I want to begin by explaining that I am going to read my invited presentation. You will see pieces of paper occasionally making their way onto the screen. And that is because if I don't read it, I'm going to likely go way off topic and never get back. So I beg your patience with being read to you, but this is the only way I can present. Judith Geller asked photographers to answer this question from their own personal experience. Which are the small steps that can help individuals maintain their mental health, recover from the problems caused by crisis, anxiety, and burnout? Ultimately, the question is, how can we be well? What role can photography play in all of this? The personal stories and perceived from our diverse life situations can lead us to revelations that act like a soothing balm, while they also give way to raise further questions. I will speak now about how do people discover these revelations inside themselves from looking at photographs, and why does this happen? Because it's human instinct to try to figure things out as we perceive something that has multiple potential meanings, and then automatically we create our own inner representation of the meaning of what we have just perceived. And then we assume everyone sees it the same way we do, because, of course, we're right. More to the topic of my presentation. How can photos be used to help people? How can mental health professionals such as psychologists, psychiatrists, therapists, make use of these unique qualities of photographs to help people improve their emotional well-being, even if it's not possible to become fully cured? After the introduction, I will speak about photographs as therapeutic tools, provide an overview to phototherapy techniques and therapeutic photography techniques that derive from them, and then provide more details, more specifically, about the five interrelated phototherapy techniques. And lastly, we'll talk about the relevance for all of this for photographers and gallery exhibitions. When I'm first exhibiting my photographs, first in informal settings like cafes and craft shops, later in formal exhibitions on the walls of real galleries, I would frequently overhear people actually arguing about the meaning of one of my photographs based on having made very different assumptions about what is the meaning of what they were seeing on the surface of that image. If they didn't know I was the photographer standing next to them, it was often possible to engage them in casual conversation about the photo in front of us. As an artist, it was intriguing to find out what others were seeing and feeling in response to an image that I myself knew very well, but one which they obviously were perceiving far differently than I had ever conceived of. I was fascinated at each demonstration of the effects of unconscious selective perception, and its proof of how so many people can see the same photograph so differently, and yet each be correct for themselves. And thus, I began to realize that there could never be a way to clearly predict what people might get from any of my photos or what emotions might be evoked as they interacted with one of them. The part of me that is a therapist was also intrigued by all the extra layers of silent communication that had been accidentally embedded along with the photo's visual details themselves, and that each viewer would be interpreting the meaning of the same photograph so differently. So from my original conception of photography as art came experiences where photographs instead could serve as nonverbal catalysts that could bring forth feelings and memories long buried from conscious awareness, regardless of any artistic merit the photo might also happen to contain. This, in turn, resulted in my realization that the value of my therapy clients' ordinary personal snapshots and their family photos could provide if used as powerful tools in the hands of those providing therapeutic assistance. In a photographic image, and also in all of reality we encounter when we look around us, it is the human being who automatically and unconsciously makes choices about what from the overall input that came in simultaneously is attended to, is noticed, and what portion of this gets remembered later. In recognizing that a photograph in and of itself cannot have any objective meaning, it can be seen how there can be no single right way to uncover any absolute truth about it. Therefore, a particular photograph cannot be read like a book or decoded deconstructively by anyone, not even a therapist or an art critic or an exhibition curator. Rather, it must be recognized that every participant in each person photo interaction has their own, correct for them, viewpoint. While the meaning of any photograph might be intended to be seen a certain way by the person who originally took it, it will always yield to a viewer's own interpretation of it based on their own personal filters for making sense of it. For this reason, any photograph will always contain stories beyond the ability of words to fully represent, and they communicate in symbolic ways that only can be selectively and unconsciously noticed. Which leads me now to talk about the what, how, and why of phototherapy techniques and how they can be used by trained mental health professionals to help people. Every photograph you take or respond to is in many ways a self-portrait, reflecting back to you what and who has mattered most in your life, leaving traces not only where you have been, but sometimes showing you where you might be going next, even if you don't realize this yet yourself. Most people keep photographs around without ever pausing to really think about why. But because these permanently record important daily moments and the associated emotions unconsciously embedded within them, personal snapshots can serve as natural bridges for accessing, exploring, and communicating about feelings and memories, along with any psychotherapeutic issues these might bring to light. Because personal snapshots and album photos are visual metaphors for an actual moment, for the experiencing of raw feelings, which also happen all at once, rather than in a certain order, they can assist people in remembering, confronting, imagining, and exploring complex parts of themselves and their lives. Using their own photographs as a bridge into their personal unconscious also gives therapy clients added support in the process of dealing with the related thoughts, feelings, and associated memories that often arise with unexpected intensity when snapshots are used as a focusing lens. A photograph is not just a two-dimensional image on a piece of paper. It's a moment of time being held, and it's been frozen there forever. But when viewed, that image is perceived as being alive and in three dimensions, and what appears in its borders seem real. And it might be able to reveal secrets if only the right kinds of questions were asked. When you look at a photograph, it immediately becomes alive right now, even if taken a long time ago, And so your mind makes the leap that you are there in that scene right now. Your mind doesn't say, I'm seeing what a mechanical object documented. Your eye is seeing what's in front of it as if you were there. Under a guide, the guidance of a therapist trained in how to ask exactly those kinds of questions, how to use phototherapy techniques, and shape clients' responses into a focused resolution of their problems, clients explore what their own personally meaningful snapshots and family photos are about emotionally, as well as what they are of visually. Based on these truths, mental health professionals all over the world have, for nearly five decades now, been using my original five-part framework of phototherapy techniques to guide their mental health practices, using ordinary snapshots and family pictures to help their clients solve personal or family problems. They discovered that having clients ask their photos the certain deep kinds of questions resulted in them learning a lot about themselves that they had previously not consciously realized. Even photos' reactions to postcards, magazine pictures, digital images viewed online, or snapshots taken by others can provide illuminating clues to their own inner life and its secrets. Such information is latent in all people's personal photos. But when it can be used to focus and precipitate therapeutic dialogue, a more direct and less censored communication and connection with the unconscious will result. Therapists often find their clients' photos frequently acting as tangible self-constructs, metaphorical transitional objects that silently offer insight, and I take that word apart in English, insight, in ways that words alone cannot fully explain or represent. During phototherapy-based sessions, clients not only view, talk about, and discuss with their therapist existing photos, but also are asked to take, pose far, actively reconstruct, visually sculpt, or create new ones, as well as remembering or imagining those photos that are not able to be brought to the session. Making the photos is just the start. Once the photo can be viewed, the next step is to activate all that it brings to mind, exploring visual messages, entering into dialogues with it, asking it questions, finding out if it has any secrets, considering the results of imagined changes, what it titled, if you could title it. Therefore, what for photographers is usually an endpoint, the finished photo, is, for phototherapy purposes, only just the beginning. The therapist's primary role is to encourage and support clients' own personal discoveries while exploring and interacting with the ordinary personal and family snapshots that narrate their lives. In such situations, the artistic components of people's snapshots quickly become irrelevant as the therapist begins to probe the inner meanings that each photo evokes in the client. This is what phototherapy techniques are based upon. Not the art part of the photo, but rather its heart part. In 1974, when I was in my 30s, I decided it would be helpful to create and use a set of photo-based helping techniques to encourage the troubled youth I was counseling, to help them explain to me more about what was happening in their lives, the things they didn't want to talk about regarding their problems. I named these techniques phototherapy techniques, two words, both with two capital letters, joined together to signal each half was equally important in the process. A year later, I published my first article about them titled Phototherapy, Photography as a Verb. According to Google, this is the first time that word phototherapy had ever appeared in print with that spelling. Print was the only thing we had in those days. There was no internet then. 1976, I began teaching phototherapy workshops, gave my first conference presentation about them in 1979 in Chicago, USA, where I met a lot of other psychologists, psychiatrists, social workers, mental health professionals who each thought, like I did, that each of them had also invented this by themselves and were going to be famous for it. My ego went down very quickly, but interacting with this new family proved to be very validating, led to a long history of many collaborative efforts, and there are other pioneers of phototherapy techniques who thought of it themselves before they ever heard of me, but we didn't have any way to know about each other because there was no internet. 1982, I opened my phototherapy center in Vancouver, Canada. And the same year, I joined my dear psychiatrist colleague, Joel Walker, in a formal gallery exhibition at Presentation House in North Vancouver, titled Beyond Seeing. It's a very long title. Beyond Seeing, the analysis of what the viewer brings to photography, including self-discovery through perception analysis, viewer participation in interpretation by means of artist tours, and writing in notebooks accompanying the images. How you see what you see. In that exhibition, we hung photos, we didn't hang titles, we hung questions. And with each photo was a notebook where viewers could write their own responses and look at other people's. In 1986, I began offering week-long intensive training workshops. And in 1993, my book, Phototherapy Techniques, Exploring the Secrets of Personal Snapshots and Family Albums, was published in hardcover, followed by paperback in 1999, and then more recently, translations into several other languages. In 2001, my website, Phototherapy and Therapeutic Photography Techniques, began, followed 10 years later by my Facebook group for these same topics. In the 10 years since that Facebook group began, it has more than 8,000 approved members. I don't accept everyone. They have to tell me how their interest or their work is relevant to phototherapy. There are 8,000 plus members in that group. More important for this presentation is the fact that during all these years of work, teaching, authoring several dozen professional publications, none of the original five-part interactive framework of phototherapy techniques that I'm about to tell you about has ever had to be modified or changed. We all see the use of photos very similarly, and those of us who pioneered it actually came up with the same five techniques. That's because they're so open-ended, flexible, and easily adaptable to all kinds of different therapeutic modalities and interventions. And also because they talk about the emotional story, emotional contents of the photo, and therefore how that image was created with a camera, with a cell phone, digital images, photographs on paper. This is not relevant to newer technology and ways of creating photos. This is only about how they're viewed and felt. My point is, I'm using the same framework since I originally invented in 1974, because these are still actively relevant. And now, after you've heard me list so many resources above, I want to make sure to pause and tell you that the final slide today is a list of how to find more information about all these things I just told you about. It includes links to all of these. It will also be made available as a downloadable PDF from the Capa Center website. Thank you, Judith. So when you come to that final slide, you're welcome to take a photo of it, but know that you can go to the website and get it into your computer directly yourself. And now I want to finally introduce you to the two main partners in this matrix of photo-based helping techniques. Phototherapy techniques are therapy practices. Therapeutic photography techniques that were adapted from the original phototherapy ones. Therapeutic photography techniques are photographic practices. And I'm going to continue reading now to explain this. Phototherapy techniques are therapy practices that use people's personal snapshots, family albums, pictures taken by others, and the feelings and thoughts and memories and associations these photos evoke as a catalyst to deepen insight, improve psychological well-being, improve personal relationships, interpersonal communication during their therapy or counseling sessions with good results after, in ways not possible using only words alone. These are techniques used only by mental health professionals who've already been fully trained in their own field and approved to practice before learning to use these techniques in their work helping people. Therapeutic photography, photographic practices, done by people themselves in situations where the skill of a trained therapist or counselor aren't needed. In therapeutic photography practices, photos are used to, this is going to sound familiar, increase people's own self-insight and awareness, improve their relationship with families and others, lessen social exclusion, assist rehabilitation, promote personal, community, and societal well-being, and produce other kinds of photo-based healing and learning by people doing these activities for themselves or to help others. Therapeutic photography is about people using cameras and photographs by and for themselves as their own agents of change, exploration, and empowerment. There are also sections of this that have to do with doing the same thing by using photos to help communities and society in general. And those have another name of the subcategory. Neither phototherapy nor therapeutic photography require any prior experience with cameras or photographic technology, nor any knowledge about photographic art. They can be used within any theoretical psychological approach and to help any kind of person or problem. The difference simply lies in the fact that phototherapy requires the professional skills of a trained therapist, whereas therapeutic photography does not. These two sets of techniques are not opposites, nor are they enemies. Instead, they should be viewed as two endpoints of a very thriving continuum along which all photo-based healing practices can be positioned without threatening or invalidating each other. While phototherapy and therapeutic photography are different in many ways, they both make use of the secret lives of ordinary non-art photographs as active agents of change, exploration, reflection, empowerment, and healing, where the art part of photography does not matter in the use of the techniques themselves. Both can include any kind of photographic imagery, including digital electronic versions, invisible, imagined, remembered ones, as long as it is perceived as a photographic image. They both use photos to meet the goals I mentioned above. Self-esteem, insight, feelings of worth get increased. Depression, despair, and hopelessness are lessened. They help with to improve coping with past horrible experiences, such as veterans returning with post-traumatic stress syndrome and other kinds of trauma, such as abuse, serious illness, grief, consequences of people's lives spinning out of control. The photos give them a tangible object to hold and use as a way to get into things because it's there. The therapist can see it even if they can't explain these things in words. These techniques are about reasons why people take, keep, look at, share, remember, and imagine photos, and why these hold so much power in people's lives. I will now continue speaking only about phototherapy techniques, not only because this is my primary specialty, but also because that's what Judith invited me to talk about. The five interrelated phototherapy techniques. Phototherapy is about photography as symbolic emotional communication, photographs used as active agents of change and insight. They are directly related. Very simple. Think of a person and a camera. People take photos. Photos are taken of them. They take pictures of themselves, self-portraits, sometimes selfies, and family photos, what I like to call photobiographical photographs. These first four, plus the last one I'll tell you in a moment, are interactions between people in photos, people in cameras, very sensible, very easy to understand, and they are very well adapted to combining, being used in combination with one another. The choice of what to do with a client is decided by the therapist as they get to know the client and find out there's things they can't find out by talking with them, and they decide to use photos as a way to get deeper. There's one more technique which underlies the other four, and that's what I have called the photoprojective technique, in that it deals with ways and reasons that a person gets any meaning from the photograph in the first place. The projective process, by which I talked about earlier, by which people make sense out of what they're seeing. How they actively project the meaning they perceived is inherent in the photograph, or in people passing them by on the street, or their family members who you find out you're seeing that child differently than your partner is. I have to separate the five techniques in order to teach them individually, but in reality, they are often blended and combined for the benefits of each when used along with another. All five phototherapy techniques are like the fingers of a hand. Photos of a person, photos by the person, self-portraits, family photos. They're like the fingers of a hand, and inseparable from it. They work best when synergistically combined. But the fifth technique, photoprojectives, acts like the thumb, without which most of these other things are useless. They're interrelated, interdependent, and for each, there's both a reflective and active component. It's not just what is done in the therapy session, but also things the therapist might ask the person to do later before returning to the next session, sort of like a homework assignment. But since this interrelated and interdependent system must be artificially taken apart in order to teach in any detail, I hope the following will provide a brief summary of each one individually. Photos that have been taken by the client, whether actually taken with a camera or taken, appropriating other people's images through gathering found photos from magazines, internet images, digital manipulation, and so forth. Number two, photos that have been taken of the client by other people, whether the person posed on purpose, or whether it was taken unaware and they didn't know it had been taken and they saw it later. But in these, all the decisions about photographing that person, the other people holding the camera have made all the decisions about when and where and how and so forth. Three, self-portraits means any kind of photos that clients have taken of themselves, literally or metaphorically. It can be of their face. It could be their favorite coffee cup, which is symbolic of them. They don't want their face in the image. They take pictures of things that symbolize them to themselves. In all cases, these photos are where the client themselves had full control over where, what, when. In other words, they have a camera taking a picture at the time they want it to, or there is another person, but that person has been told, don't tell me what you're seeing. You know, if it turns out that the picture shows me with a tree coming out of the back of my head, that's fine. I'm in charge of this photo, not you. For family albums, family albums now are often online as Pinterest or whatever. And so again, an album is no longer a paper album. All of this still works equally well. It's of your birth family. It could be of your family of choice, whether formally kept in albums or more loosely combined into narratives by placement on walls or refrigerator doors or inside your purse or desktop frames, were put together for the purpose of documenting the personal narratives of that client's life, the background from which they developed. Such collections have a life apart from and far beyond the individual images which comprise them. A photo being viewed and then another photo being viewed on an album page, there's a narrative. One comes after the other. Why was that one there instead of there? And on the exploration goes by a therapist trained in how to use photos, particularly for a family systems model, if it's a whole family they're working with, or if the individual client's family personal issues are due to family situations. Finally, photo projectives, which makes use of the phenomenological fact that the meaning of any photo is primarily, you've heard this several times now, primarily created by the viewer during their process of perceiving it. Looking at any kind of photographic image affects how it is seen and interpreted, and therefore, this technique is not located in a particular kind of photo of the person by the person, but rather in the less tangible interface between a photo and its viewer or maker, the place where each person forms their own unique responses. Each of these five kinds of techniques has its own special reasons for being useful in therapy, and therefore each is used to activate the process that the therapist has already decided will be the most important for that client to participate in during that particular session, because they're a trained therapist and they're on the path of trying to achieve a particular goal that needs certain steps to be accomplished, and that's how they decide which technique to use. These are tools. Even if you fully know them properly, you don't use them in a therapy session until you already have in mind the outcome goal for that particular session, and then you decide what kind of therapeutic intervention will get you there. Since phototherapy techniques are used as a set of interrelated flexible techniques rather than fixed directives based on only one kind of theoretical modality or therapeutic paradigm, they can be used by any kind of trained mental health professional, regardless of that person's own preferred theoretical modality. They can be used by someone who does Freudian therapy and equally well by someone who hates Freudian therapy. It's also regardless of whatever intervention techniques they have been additionally trained. So in fact, phototherapy techniques are often used by art therapists because it is still an expressive art modality. Also important is the simple fact that since phototherapy is about photography as communication, rather than photography as art, no prior experience with cameras, photographic technology, nor the photographic arts is required for effective therapeutic use using phototherapy techniques. Judith asked me if there was time, would I please share a few real life examples? And that's what I'm about to do. She can edit this out if my presentation has gone too long. Before I show you these and read the stories written by the people interacting in them, I want to take care of ethics and assure you that I have written permission from any person in any photo I show and any person who has agreed to let me use their story when I give examples. I will first show you the photo and let you explore it, then thoughts and feelings and memories that arise when you view it. And then I'll read you the story about what it meant to the people I was helping. So now I ask you to look at the first photo. It is a person sitting, it's a person looking out from inside a train car. I can tell you why I took the photo. I can tell you a bit about what it was supposed to be about. But the key of this is one of the 100 or so photographs that I use when I'm teaching a workshop. And if you come into one of my teaching events, you will walk in the first morning and you will see about 100 black and white photos all over a tabletop. And they don't have titles. And I do many different things with them depending on the focus of the training. The easiest thing to do is to say, find a photo that you particularly like. It particularly calls to you. Maybe you don't like it, but it's real strong. It chooses you. Pick a photo and we'll talk about them. And I go into a lecture about the photoprojective technique. And then I ask people to pair off and talk about the photo. I give them a handout to use. And so this story is one that a therapist chose. She wrote me about her response, and I thought it was so excellent. She has actually given me permission for it to be on my website. So if you go to my website's page about phototherapy techniques and the page for projective technique, and you click the link to more information, you can see this photo and her story. I will read now her story. Before I do that, think about what you're seeing. What's it about? Why is that person there? What's going on? Why did you choose? I made you choose, but why did you choose this one? What does it say about yourself and things that interest you? And how would you title it? And would you change something if you could? It's the kind of questions therapists ask. I now quote, "A particular photograph on the table in my therapist's office, where dozens of pictures were kept for viewing, called to me, and so I picked it up to look at it. It's a photo of someone looking out a broken window. In the reflection of the window, there are trees." How many of you noticed that? "The walls that the window is attached to are steel with rivets in them. My reflections, is it a train, a building, a prison? It made me in some ways think of the men I worked with in the prison environment. They were far away from home, and even though there were trees around them, it was an indigenous Native American, Aboriginal, people who were here before any white people came, whatever the term is over there in Budapest. It was an indigenous justice model used in this prison setting that I worked at. Traditional healing involved environments and methods, but it was nonetheless, they were in prison." Those are side thoughts. "I knew that I chose the photo because it said something about me and not something about someone else. I just wasn't sure what it said. I had to sit with it for quite a while to try to understand what it meant and why it was so strong for me. The face in the window looked tired. That was how I feel. I have been in school for 10 years now, and I am just tired. Tired of the constant struggle for money, time, and sanity. Tired of having to constantly fight for what I believe in. And, well, just tired. I have not had any kind of vacation in 7 years. Why the broken window? Where is this person? I felt the person was on a train that was like a prison. They're going somewhere, but they can't get off. They can't get off the train until it stops, like my school experience. The only connection they have to the outside world is through the broken window. My own occasional glimpses of life walking in the park, going for coffee with friends, visiting people. The person is not miserable, they're just tired. They know that they have to stay on the train and they won't get off till they get to the end of the ride, which could still be years and years away. That's how I feel. I had no plans of staying in school this long. I'm not an academic at heart. I wanted to get an art degree, get more skills, maybe write children's books. Here I am, 10 years later, sitting on the same train. I've almost forgotten what it's like to live in a world that is not so full of so many isolating feelings and tasks, like writing, the academic kind, not the creative kind. Marks, grades totally perplex and freeze me. The coldness of certain professors. I guess if people keep you at a distance, they can keep the hierarchy in place. And the lack of extended periods of being able to relax in nature and just let my thoughts go. As I look back on the image, I could say that I feel somewhat suffocated and constrained. I can see the trees, but I can't touch them. I can see outside this train prison, but I can't get off until the ride is over. I would get off if I wanted to, but then I wouldn't be where I need to be. I need to get off in the right place, so I have to suffer this isolating ride. I found this sad and enlightening at the same time, because after all, the train ride goes on forever. So that is her story about this photo. And for my second example, I'm going to show you a photo that is things you've seen, a little family photograph that a client brought me that was taken in the 40s. And I'll read you now about this. She asked me to put it in the third person. She didn't do I, me. She said, one middle-aged client explored with me. A photo from a family gathering where she was 11 years old. She's the final child in a long line of children. And here you see her sort of close to the edge, the back part of a grouping that included her siblings, nephews, and nieces, some of whom were older than herself. Looking at her face and body in the photo, sort of trying to get in, she defined this for me as herself just barely managing to be seen, struggling massively not to be left out of the picture altogether. She described this feeling as continuing throughout her life because she had so many siblings. And it said it suddenly began to ring true for her when she realized that the field she had chosen to work in as an adult all her life made her highly visible to the public. As you can see in the photo, she said, I was like the barely seen child. I was barely there. I was barely seen in my family. I was born after a whole bunch of other siblings ahead of me. Nobody really knew I was there. This picture is such a perfect example of me trying to break through all of that and be seen. And yet, on the surface, it's just a picture of people in a lineup. And now I move to the next section of my presentation, relevance for art photographers and gallery exhibitions. As I have mentioned above, it becomes clear that the actual meaning of any photograph lies in what its visual details brings up in each viewer. My use of photographs and phototherapy techniques also are about the heart part of photos rather than their art part, which can be a bit confusing for art photographers and art critics such as Victor Bergen and Simon Watney, who write books and teach that it's possible to interpret and deconstruct the meaning of someone else's photograph from an external, outside observer perspective. And they can teach others how to do this. I believe this can have serious import for the assumptions underlying formal photo exhibitions. I know I have often felt like a failure after exiting a photo exhibition where I truly didn't understand what I was supposed to have been looking at. and what I was supposed to be getting from what I was looking at, and too embarrassed to ask for more explanation. So, regarding the questions I now ask below about such experiences, I am not able to give you any answers, but I want to give you some comments, some possible challenges, and many questions. The first thing I want to call attention to is the difference between viewing any kind of artwork and viewing a photograph. And by artwork, I mean a painting, a watercolor, a sculpture, art things. Okay. And I'm going to summarize here now from the elegant writing in 1983 by my dear psychologist colleague, Dr. David Krause in Ohio in the United States, another early pioneer, about the theoretical underpinnings of phototherapy. I quote, "Although art and photography both utilize the method of pictorial representation, they do this in very different ways. Since art of any media is dependent upon the externalization of internal images, and photography is dependent on internalized external images, they deal with different aspects of personal symbolism. Therefore, when anybody views an artwork, they usually realize, even if only unconsciously, they're seeing a selective view of reality as perceived and then expressed by that artist. And then another artist standing beside them in the same scene would create an artwork that looks very different. We're okay with this. We understand that. Several artists in front of the same scene will always, you know, paint or whatever differently because of who they are and what their styles are and what matters, what makes a difference in the whole field. It's called in therapy a Ganzfeld, the whole field of what's in front of their eyes. But when people view photographs, something different happens. Photographs taken of the same scene by numerous photographers, even standing elbow to elbow, believe that everyone's seeing the same scene like they are, and yet the photographs are very different, but they don't get the connection that that's because of what was happening inside the person. So if it is true that any one photograph can convey multiple meanings in the minds of hearts of viewers, and sometimes even in the same viewer as they continue to examine one photograph a bit longer, then how can photographers and exhibition organizers ever know how to plan an exhibit of photographs that will produce the desired results in most of the visitors to the exhibition? Secondly, usually there's titles added to photographs in most exhibitions I've ever gone to. Doesn't the adding of titles automatically limit the freedom with which the viewer sees the photo for the first time? Don't titles carry the presumption that there's a correct way to interpret this photo and its meaning? Should titles perhaps be hidden under a blank piece of paper that for those who do not want to know in advance what they're supposed to be seeing, and they could lift the paper up if they want to see the title, but they don't have to. Is it okay not to look at the title at all and presume one's own interpretation is sufficient? Number three, when the announcement is sent out about the newest upcoming exhibition that describes what viewers will be seeing and learning there, are people being already shaped into the proper way with which to approach and encounter and evaluate what they're going to be seeing when they walk into the exhibition? Number four, either photographers are already famous enough to have their collections of photos shown even if there's no clear theme other than it's their photos. I'm thinking of exhibitions of Ansel Adams or, you know, very, very famous photographers who you see an exhibition of their work, you can see their own kind of theme, but it wasn't like an exhibition because somebody did a call for proposals and submissions. Or more commonly, some curator organizes an exhibition either along their own choice of theme and then selects whose photographs best fit this, Or they prepare a call for submissions about a topic, which they hope has been clearly communicated, and then they evaluate their proposals that are received according to how well the photographer's submission meets those expectations. But how can the curator know how the photos that are sent in truly connect with the theme? Unless the photographers are also required to explain why they are submitting the particular photos that they are submitting. But should the photographer need to explain? Or should this already be obvious to the judge who's making the acceptance decision? And I'm also curious about the experiences of each photographer during this process. Each will likely be interpreting the assignment given in the call differently, and that perception of theirs will guide their choice of photos to fit the theme as best they can. Some might take new photos, others might want to involve photos they've taken in the past, if that's permitted by the rules. In taking new photos, will they go out and photograph what they spontaneously encounter, or do they work from a pre-planned list of what they want to capture? If those photos include people, for example, did they pose the people, or was that just how they were when the photographer walked by with the camera? Next, I also found it personally very interesting to try to decide whether this exhibition, based on its call and results, was aware that it might have had a component of therapeutic photography in its design and results. Most times I would consider a formal gallery exhibition to be a combination of documentary photography and art photography. But did Judith's wonderful, interesting wording and plan make this one both, since the assigned theme also connects directly with photos and well-being? Judith's going to have to answer that one. Lastly, I would have loved to have had the opportunity to do what I have done before and enjoyed so thoroughly and learned a lot from. I would have loved to have had the opportunity to walk through the rooms of this exhibition in person and explore with each photographer, interview them about what does each photo mean to them and what was the meaning they hoped each viewer would see, and how did they choose which photos to submit from amongst the larger collection of possibilities. Were there any surprises? Did they plan all the photos in advance before shooting, or just go out looking for things that caught their eye that seemed to connect with the theme? What criteria did they use to select the final ones to submit? How did they decide on the title, if there are titles? And what other titles did they consider but reject? And of course, why? In phototherapy, you're always asking why. Many more questions like these come to mind. So, in conclusion, I hope that by now you have done a bit of deeper thinking regarding what happens when a photo is viewed, especially on the walls of a gallery, since this was the reason I was asked to speak about my specialty in phototherapy today. I hope that not only have you done some deeper thinking about how you yourself walk up to a photo in a gallery and engage in mutual nonverbal communication, but how you do this the same way when interacting with informal photos in your personal life. Just ask yourself, why do you take photos? Why do you keep them? Would you still take them if you knew that nobody except you would ever see them? What photos would you take if this was the last time you could take a photograph? If your home was on fire and you could only save 10 personal photographs, which ones would you choose? And no, photos on digital storage backup devices don't count in this answer. What would be different in your life if photography ceased to exist? So much more is living inside photographs than people realize. Photos create meaning, connect you with feelings, hold secrets, trigger memories, tell their own stories, whether as used as tools for therapy, less formal helping of oneself or others, or as social action projects to increase well-being and reduce social exclusion in communities and society. No matter what you do with them, photographs are usually truly worth way more than the proverbial 1,000 words we've heard about. Both phototherapy techniques and therapeutic photography techniques are about the secret lives of ordinary non-art photographs as active agents of change, exploration, reflection, and personal learning, in addition to possibly being art objects to be passively viewed and appreciated. Very simply, in summary, both of these kinds of photo-based helping techniques are about the why of photography. Phototherapy is always done as part of formal therapy. Therapeutic photography is done without any need for a therapist to be involved. Phototherapy is a therapy practice. Therapeutic photography is a photographic practice. Both are used to help people regardless of whether the photos involved are of a person, by the person, self-portraits, family photos, or even just imagined or remembered ones that cannot be really seen in real life. Both of these collections of techniques I have presented not as a closed, fixed model with rules about how to do it right, but rather as a set of flexible tools with rules about how to ask questions to find out what you're seeking information about. And a therapist will tailor this to each client's individual needs and goals. I hope that by now my presentation has made it clear that any photograph viewed anywhere is just the beginning to open the door to a longer story and its related feelings and memories as people explore what is happening below the surface of a photograph. What Judith quotes Jorge Luis Borges as calling the eye interpreting the text of the shadows. And that the why of each photograph, what it means to each viewer, is important to explore anytime there is a discussion, any discussion involved, even during exhibitions curated by strangers. For this reason, I am so very sad that I can't be at the Capa Gallery in person to lead a guided tour through this exhibition, as I've done so many times before, the Seattle Art Museum, the three Social Photo Fest exhibitions in Perugia, Italy, as part of the conference, and others, to engage the viewers in active dialogue with the images in front of them as we walk through the galleries and look at photos on all the walls and talk about what we're seeing. I would love to be able to engage the viewer in exploring the photo more deeply and explore the meaning. They think everyone's seeing the same way they do. They are. And it would be even better if each of the photographers could be there to observe this discussion while remaining as one more anonymous participant in the conversations until the end, when I turn to ask them and identify them and ask them to share their own observations about what they just heard. Thank you very much for listening to all this. I hope it has answered some of your questions. The next slide ends my presentation and it tells you how to get more information. And again, I remind you that the same slide can be downloaded as a PDF from the gallery's website. And thank you very much. I've enjoyed talking with you.